If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice, tell the same old lies, if you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, a savior, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker.
All right. Good morning, everybody. How's everybody feeling this morning? Oh, wow. Are you sure? Somebody said good. I hope you are, because we're in church. Amen. We're going to lift up the name of Jesus. We're going to magnify him. We're going to praise him together today. I got some quick announcements that I've got to make. Make sure that you pass these on, because we're probably not going to be filled up for another 15 minutes. It looks like people are moving a little slow this morning. That's fine. So spread the word about what's going on. Awakening Youth is kicking back off this Friday night, 6:30. We're going to do an outdoor movie at the home of the farmers. Thank you guys so much for hosting that. We're kicking youth back off, and we're going to continue to meet after that. So we want to get the youth group back together. That's starting this Friday with an outdoor movie. Now, also, our tent service is happening September the 10th through the 13th. We're going to do the weeknight services and the Sunday service right here on the grounds. The weeknight services are going to be at 7 p.m. We have got an awesome lineup. We've got our brother and our son of Antioch, Anthony Clore, is going to be preaching on Thursday night. We got Pastor Washington from the Bridge on Friday. We got Pastor Stacy Fincham and the Freedom Band on Saturday, and then I'm bringing it on Sunday. So you don't want to miss it. How many of you know you can't plan a revival? You certainly can't cancel a revival. Amen. We need God to show up, and we're gonna depend on him to show up, and we're gonna do it right here on the grounds. We're gonna be under the tent right here. We're also gonna do a catered meal on that Sunday, so make sure you let Miss Stephanie Sprouse know. Stephanie, wave at everybody. If you don't know who she is, just email or message the church office or myself. We have got to know who is coming on that Sunday. If you don't let us know you're coming, we're not gonna feed you. That should give you some incentive. It would give me incentive. All right, I'm telling the church that 2 day votes are coming because I want 2 boxes. Come on, somebody. I'm just kidding. I'll share some with you. We've got to know you're coming. Also, we've been talking about opening up the church for virtual learning this school year. We are going to have a call business meeting this Wednesday night at 7 p.m. We want to hear from you. We need your help to make that happen, and we need your input to figure out what exactly we're going to do so we can get the word out to the community. If you're a member of this church, this Wednesday night, 7 p.m., we need you here. We're going to make a collective decision on how to best reach the community. Amen? You have a voice. So exercise it. So use it. We want your input. We need your help. 7 p.m. this Wednesday night. All right, who's ready to worship? Anybody? Let's get up on our feet and go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we praise you and thank you. This is the day you've made. We are so grateful that you're still on the throne. We're so thankful, oh God, that we can gather in your name, free from fear of persecution. We can lift up the name of Jesus. We can worship together. We can pray together. We can go to the Word of God together. We're so grateful. And Lord, we thank you for everyone who's watching from home. We thank you for that technology that makes that available. We pray for a special blessing to everyone tuning in online. Lord, we thank you for that. We thank you that we can worship you however we feel comfortable right now. You will receive our praise. No matter where it's from, whether it's from our living rooms, from this building, from our trucks, our cars, our offices, wherever we're at, we can worship you. I thank you for that opportunity, and we thank you for everyone joining in. Lord, let your name be lifted up this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good. Dear Lord, we just come to you this morning humbled for the life you give us, the experiences you give us, dear Lord, and the ability to praise you, worship you openly, dear Lord. We're so thankful. In the middle of the storm, dear Lord, we're still thankful. We love you. Praise you, dear Lord. Watch over us, protect us. Bring healing to the ones that are hurt, dear Lord. May we get one blessing out of this day. May we lay it at your feet. It's in your name we pray.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. And holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Yeah. With all creation I sing praise to
so grateful this morning that you are high above the heavens, crowned on the throne of power, seated in glory. Lord, we echo with heaven to sing, holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. Lord, with all the hosts of heaven who are falling down at your feet right now, we sing, holy, holy, holy. All honor, all glory to you and to you alone, King Jesus, we pray in Jesus' name. Somebody in this house say amen and give the Lord a praise. Come on, somebody. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. And thank you, worship team. Great job, guys. Open up in your Bibles to the book of Colossians. We're diving back in to our Above All series. How many of you know Christ is above all? Amen. Amen. All right. We got some folks chiming in this morning. I like that. I like it when you talk back to me a little bit, not too much. I don't like it when you tell me what to do. I just like it when you say amen. Now, remember, Paul is writing from prison. He is in prison now, and he didn't get locked up for thieving or thugging or drinking or drugging. He got locked up for preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. So have you ever felt like you've been punished when you're trying to do the right thing? Can anybody say, I felt like that before, Pastor Dave? I know I have. That's the condition that Paul is in. But instead of wallowing in his pain and in his circumstance, what's he doing? He's writing to the churches. We have four epistles that we know were written during Paul's imprisonments. One of them is the book of Colossians. And he's writing to a young church in Colossae, very young, maybe 5 years old, that was being led away. This church was being led away by false teaching that was taking them away from the centrality of Christ. Paul is writing them saying, look, Jesus is all that you need. The gospel is good news, and it is simple, and it is easy enough for a child to understand it, but it's also profound enough that no matter how many times you read through it or know it, you'll never understand the fullness of it. It doesn't need anything. Jesus is enough. He's writing to remind them of that. I think we all need to be reminded of that. Jesus plus anything ruins everything. Jesus plus anything ruins everything. He is supreme above all. He is sufficient. Christ is more than enough. Amen. He's all that we need. He's all that we need. He's supreme over all creation. And last week, my father preached and taught that we need to let Christ be above all, above fear in our hearts and in our minds. That was an awesome word from Pastor Greg. We also need to let Christ be Lord of all in every area of our life. Now, that's easier said than done, isn't it? The hard part of the Christian life is actually letting Christ have control over everything. We know that Christ is above creation. We need Christ above corona. We need Christ above racism. We need Christ above the mask debate. We need Christ above the election, above religion, above natural disasters, above our relationships, above even hunting, fishing, and shopping, and even classic wrestling. Woo! Christ has to be above all. We've got to allow him to be Lord of all in our lives. And if I can get to page 2, I'll go on to my next point. But if I can't, I'm just going to preach on that all morning. There's enough there. Listen, we allow all these lesser things to creep into our lives. Christ has to be above all. Amen. I need like Vanna White up here, a professional page turner. We need Christ above virtual learning, above all the stuff. We need him above all. We know that he is first in the universe, so we need to make him first in our lives. Amen. Paul just finished writing about the most theologically rich parts of all of Scripture in the book of Colossians. It's one thing to say amen at the awesomeness of God, but that's part of what we have to do. The other part is we also have to actually sit down and assess how we're allowing him to have his leadership in the daily practical parts of our lives. That's the hard part. Well, that's what he transitions into in this next section of Colossians. Paul writes that the God the Father was pleased to have all of his fullness dwell in Christ. Look at that verse. Perfect timing. Look what that verse says. God was pleased. There is no conflict or power struggle in the Trinity. God the Father is happy that Christ is representative of all of his fullness. And we know that the Holy Spirit's job is to draw all people back to the heart of the Father. How does he do that? By convicting them of sin and convincing them that they need Jesus. That's the Holy Spirit's job. But it's all working through Jesus. He's the front man in the band. And they're not going to split up like Journey or any of the other big bands that have split up because they got jealous over who had the mic. No, God is pleased. The Father's pleased. The Holy Spirit's pleased. Christ is all, and He is above all. Amen. Now, we have to, I like to amen the big truths, but we have to assess how well those big truths are directly affecting our lives. Are we actually living what we say we believe? Sooner or later, I've said it this way before and I'll say it again. What you know has to have an impact on where and how you go. It has to become daily practical. Let's stand up and let's read. We'll start with Colossians 1:19 and we'll read through the end of chapter 1. I was going to try to get through the beginning of chapter 2, but I was just honest with myself and said there's just too much good stuff here. There is no way Pastor Dave's going to be able to preach that much. So you're welcome in advance. I did you a favor. You can thank me later. Colossians 1:19-29 says this. God was pleased to have all His fullness dwell in Him. To Him there is Christ. And through Him, Christ, to reconcile everything to Himself by making peace through the blood of His cross, whether things on earth or things in heaven. We talked about that a couple weeks ago. Christ is the reconciler. Look at verse 21. Once you were alienated and hostile in your minds because of your evil actions, but now He has reconciled you to His physical body through His death to present you holy, faultless, and blameless before Him. If indeed you remain grounded and steadfast in the faith and are not shifted away from the hope of the gospel that you heard. This gospel has been proclaimed in all creation under heaven, and I, Paul, have become a servant of it. 24, now I rejoice in my sufferings. Look at that. Wow. I rejoice in my sufferings for you, and I am completing in my flesh what is lacking in Christ's affliction for His body, that is the church. And I have become its servant according to God's administration that was given to me for you to make God's message fully known, the mystery hidden for ages and generations, but now is revealed to His saints. God wanted to make known among the Gentiles the glorious wealth of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. We proclaim Him, warning and teaching everyone with all wisdom, so that we may present everyone mature in Christ. I labor for this, striving with His strength that works powerfully in me. You can be seated. How do we take that beautiful doctrine and make it into our everyday lives? We have to recognize Christ above our sin, number one. Point number one. Only 2 points today. Christ above our sin. Paul tells us, you were once alienated and hostile to the things of God. Before you are saved, you are cut off. Why? Because you're committing evil deeds. It means that we were estranged from God. We were separated from God. We were condemned. We weren't invited to the party. In other words, you weren't in the club. You were left out in the cold. You didn't have a ticket. You were without hope and you were headed to hell in a handbasket. But then, how many of you know there was Jesus, like we sang this morning? Then Christ came in when you were unable to save yourself, and He redeemed you and reconciled you, and He built the bridge that led the way back to God. If that is such a glorious truth, amen? Now, Christ saved you. You know why? Because Paul says He actually wants to be there in person when you are face-to-face with God the Father for the first time. When you are saved and you go to heaven, Christ is going to personally lead you to God the Father and introduce you to Him. Now, you've believed in Him all your life in faith. Your whole Christian life, you've believed one day that faith is going to become sight and Christ is going to present you to the Father. He wants you to look good on that day. My mama would said, son, if you're going to a job interview, you don't want to look like a bum. Hello. Have you ever tried to introduce somebody to somebody else? And I remember when Laura wanted to introduce me to her parents and I pulled up at the door and she opened the door and she looked at me and she said, just like that. You know that? Have you ever gotten this look, guys, from your wife? It's not a smile. It's more like a gritted teeth look. You're wearing that? What she was saying was, you need to make a good impression on my folks. You need to look better. When we're presented to Christ, Paul says that He wants to present us faultless, blameless, and holy to the Father. He wants you to look your best. How do we do that? We prepare for that now by the way we live on the earth. Paul emphasizes that Christ has reconciled us through His body. Remember, the Gnostic thought was that Jesus was not really a person. That was part of the false teaching that Paul is combating. They were believing that Jesus was kind of like a holographic image or a spirit image. You know, something like in Star Wars, after all the Jedi die and then they show up as blue people. That's what they were teaching. Christ was kind of like that. Paul is saying, no, he was fully God and he was fully man. And the only reason that you're reconciled, the only reason you have that access back to the Father is because through his physical body, through the brutal murder on the cross, he brought you back and paid for your sin. There's no way to get around the atonement. You were a sinner. You needed a Savior. A price had to be paid, and you were broke. Jesus paid it. That's the gospel. If you get away from that, you are getting away from the truth. It's the only way. Paul is trying to reground them, refocus them. He's trying to tell them, look, God, he reconciled you through his body. You got to have some skin in the game. Christ did. And Paul said, I've been crucified with Christ daily. I don't think he meant that actually, literally. I don't think I'm going to go outside and hammer nails through my wrist because I'm a wuss and I would chicken out before I did it anyway. What's he saying? He just as Christ sacrificed himself for you, we sacrifice ourselves for others to bring them back to God. So maybe not nails in hands and feet. Maybe it looks like a mask on the face or keeping a distance right now from people who don't feel comfortable. Maybe that's how you can reconcile someone with your body. How are you physically engaging in the reconciliation ministry that Christ has given the church? Paul was working for it. Paul is saying we have access back to God because Christ is above our sin. He defeated our sin through his death, and he saved us to set us apart. God set you free from sin so that you would live free of sin. That's why he saved you. Not so that you can now go do whatever you want because God loves you and he'll forgive me. No, now I can actually draw closer to him, so I should want more of him. He saved me from sin so I would live free of sin. He saved us and cleanses us. He wants to present us. Now, he goes on. Paul's telling the church, how do we live this confident Christianity where we know we're living a life that pleases God the Father? Look what he says in verse 23. He says, if you remain grounded and steadfast in the faith, and are not shifted away from the hope of the gospel that you heard. You have to remain grounded and steadfast, not shifted away. Colossae back in the ancient world was known for earthquakes. That's why he uses this phrase. He says, you can't, when the earth starts shaking and quaking, you can't run from your faith. You can't shift off of the foundation of Christ. You have to stay anchored. We just got back from a camping trip. We were camping on the Eastern Shore, and we were some of the only people who still camp in tents. There is like 1,000 campers. That's not camping. You should just stay at home and sleep in your house if that's how you want to camp. Right? It's like if you don't like your house that much that you need to buy a smaller house, hook it up to your truck, and drive away. Listen, just you camp in a tent. That's just how I was raised, okay? Now, maybe if I had more money, I would buy a camper, but I can't afford it. So we're the only people, and the kids are walking around. They're saying, where's your camper? They're like, oh, we're staying in tents. The little kid said, what? Why are you sleeping in a tent? Because we're broke, that's why. But if you've ever been down on the Eastern Shore, there is a constant blowing wind. Every night, I'm sitting in my tent, the tent's going, constantly. And I'm looking out the window in the kids' tents. And I'm like, oh man, I really hope we don't blow away in the middle of the night. How many of you know? I'm glad that I put down a couple extra stakes. I'm glad that I anchored those things in the ground and they didn't move. Listen, some point in your life, things are going to start shaking up. The winds are going to blow. Trials are going to come. Hardships come. You will never be able to avoid that. That's what life on this planet involves. You had better be anchored. You had better be grounded. You had better be steadfast. Don't shift away from the hope of the gospel. Stay grounded in Christ. Why? Because he's above our sin. Boy, in 2020, haven't we experienced a few tremors in this world? I'd say so. Saw a guy camping, had a big shirt. It said, 2020 sucks. The only thing this shirt said. Every time he went past somebody, everybody said, yeah, that's right, yeah, that's right, yeah, that's right. I don't know about you, but Jesus didn't stop ruling just because of coronavirus or because I got to wear a mask when I go into the store or because I have to figure out how I'm supposed to walk through Walmart and follow the green arrows. Christ is still on the throne. We're going to be all right. We're going to make it. This isn't the end of the world. Listen to me. When the tribulation really starts revving up, coronavirus is going to look like a Sunday picnic. I'm telling you, read the end of the book. You better get grounded now. Because if this will shake you, ain't nobody ready for what's about to come. We got to prepare. You got to put extra stakes down in the ground because Christ is above our sin. Second reason, Christ is above our suffering. Look at verse 24. How did Paul react when things started to get shook up? This is one of the most amazing phrases in the entire Bible. Look what he says. Now I rejoice in my sufferings for you. What? Anybody here ever suffered? I don't know about you, but I'm the kind of guy that when things start going bad, I am not the positive, optimistic person. Don't you? I hate being around those people. Oh, well, it's going to be all right. I'm like, no, it's not. What are you, crazy? Do you see what's happening? It's easy for us to get into that. How did Paul react when things got shook up in his life? He says, I rejoice. He found reason to be joy. It's not happiness. Happiness is based on outward circumstances. Joy is based on an inward reality that Christ, the hope of glory, is in me, and my reservation in heaven is secure. Nothing's going to take that from me. No matter what happens, I'm good in the next life. That's hope you can't buy. All right, it don't matter how you can have that Cabela's credit card and you can go max that sucker out. You won't find hope on any shelf in any store. I'm just telling you, it ain't there. It only comes from Jesus. Listen to me. There's no way to avoid suffering in the Christian life. I love Paul's reaction. Paul suffered a lot. When you read back through the New Testament, let me tell you some of the things Paul endured. He was beaten. He was whipped. He was stoned, this kind, not this kind. He had rocks thrown at him, and he was left for dead. He was shipwrecked twice. Many times he was hungry, many times naked, many times abandoned by pretty much everyone, imprisoned on multiple occasions for preaching the gospel. And listen, when he wasn't in prison, there was a mob of Jewish radicals that wanted to kill him because he was telling the Gentiles people besides the Jews could be saved. This guy is safer in jail than he is on the street. Every time he preaches, there are riots breaking out, and eventually he was killed for preaching the gospel. Paul didn't know anything about this health and wealth, blessed life now. It didn't exist in his world. It really don't exist in the New Testament. Our blessings are eternal blessings. They're not of this world. Does God bless us here? Yeah, he does. And when he does, we praise him for it. But when he doesn't, we realize that we're blessed enough because we're saved. He says, I rejoice in my suffering. Paul letting this young church know, you can't prevent or control suffering. Bad things are going to happen to you. You will suffer as a Christian. What you can control is how you react when the suffering comes. That's what you have power over. You can't control any other suffering. All you can choose is your reaction. How do I do that, Pastor Dave? How do I let Christ be above my suffering? I think, first of all, you got to be ready for it. You got to be ready for it. The Bible talks a lot about suffering. Paul and the other apostles, they were prepared. They expected to suffer. We don't. We build so much of our lives trying to eliminate every single hardship from our life. It's why you have a microwave. It's why you have instant meals. Nobody anymore is going out and churning their own butter and milking their own cow. And I mean, those we don't do. We create creature comforts for ourselves so that we can make everything easier. And when suffering comes, we feel like we've done something wrong. You haven't necessarily done anything wrong. It's just a part of life. They were prepared for it. We're not. I was listening to a recent teaching on suffering, and the pastor that was teaching listed out 13 different types of suffering. That's a lot of suffering. I'm just going to go through them quick. I'm not going to preach on all of them, but there's endemic suffering. We suffer because we're in a fallen world. There's demonic suffering. It's called spiritual warfare. There's victim suffering, when you've done nothing wrong and it just comes at you and it's done to you. There's collective suffering, when from terrorist attacks and racism, where groups of people suffer. There's disciplinary suffering, where God as a loving father allows you to experience some suffering to work out your character. There's persecution. There's empathetic suffering, where you feel somebody else's pain. There's testimonial suffering, where God allows you to go through something so that you can bless somebody else. There's providential suffering, like what happened in the life of Joseph. There's mysterious suffering. There's times when you just have no idea what's going on. You're just suffering and you have no idea why. There's punishment suffering. There's consequential suffering, right? Like when you're just on the Edo diet, Cheetos, Fritos, Taquitos, and Doritos. Listen, you have a health problem, that's not God punishing you. That's consequential suffering. Find a vegetable and eat it. You can have an effect on that. All right, then, and then there's apocalyptic suffering, which the Bible says there will be roars, wars and rumors of wars, earthquakes and famines, the love of many will grow cold. There's suffering that's going to happen as we get closer to the return of Christ. That's coming. Nothing you can do to avoid it or prevent it. It's going to happen because God is going to judge a sinful world eventually. You had better be ready. That's a lot of suffering, isn't it? What's the good news? Christ is above it. Christ is above it. And he can carry you through it. You have to be ready. You have to be ready. Listen, and suffering's complicated, isn't it? Because sometimes it's mostly our fault. Other times it's a little bit our fault. Other times it's not our fault at all. What do we do? Well, you have to identify with your Savior, not with your suffering. Identify with the Savior. Paul says in this, he says, I'm suffering. I'm completing in my flesh what is lacking in Christ's affliction for his body that is the church. Paul's not saying in verse 24 that he needs to add anything. He's just saying, I'm suffering with Christ and for Christ, and it's a privilege. I'm rejoicing in it. It's not what I wanted. It's not what I expected, but I'm going to praise God through everything. Why? Because even in the desert season, he's still there. There was Jesus. It's really, we got to be very careful because suffering can really narrow our focus. It can put us on the throne, and we all want to ask that magic question, that three-letter word, why? When we begin to ask why, we need to be careful that we don't put God on trial. Remember, he's the judge, jury, and executioner. We are the peasant on the earth. We can't put him on trial. But we want to know. Paul doesn't ask why. We have to understand. We have to ask the right kind of questions. When you go and start asking, why am I going through this? Have you ever realized that you just begin to focus on your suffering and you ignore everyone else's suffering? Other people are going through hardship. Like my grandmama used to say, somebody else always has it worse off than you do. I don't care about that. Don't you know what I'm going through? We get this narrow focus. We get self-centered. Victims are self-centered. Victorious people are other-centered. Even in their suffering, they know Christ is above it. You got to ask the right question, and why isn't it? It's a natural response. It's a normal response. God is patient and loving, but there's some other questions that we can ask. Questions like, what? Lord, what can I learn through this? Instead of asking why, maybe ask what? Instead of asking why, maybe ask how? Lord, how can you use this to bring me closer to you? Instead of asking why, you could also ask who? Lord, who else can I minister through this? The Bible says that God comforts us in all of our sufferings and in all of our afflictions. Why? So that we can then turn around and comfort other people with the same comfort we've received. I can then reach out and say, hey, brother, I know what you're going through. It really stinks right now, but hang in there. It's like that, you remember that Lord of the Rings? Everybody remember Lord of the Rings? When Frodo is carrying that ring and he's right at the end of the journey. And his good buddy, Samwise, you need a couple good buddies. And Samwise says, Frodo, I'll carry the ring for you. He says, no, you can't carry it. I got to carry it. And what does Samwise say? He says, I may not be able to carry the ring, but I can carry you. And he puts Frodo on his back and he carries him up the mountain. That's what you need. You got to look outward and say, even though I'm suffering, I'm going to honor Christ. Even though Paul is in prison suffering, he's still looking outward and suffering and ministering and working for the church. That's a hard mentality to have, but please, I'm telling you, instead of obsessing over our pain, we got to focus on the purpose of God. Instead of asking why, maybe focus on the why, meaning the purpose of God in the situation and in our life. Paul rejoiced because he had the privilege of spreading the greatest message in the whole world. It says in verse 27, it's Christ in you, the hope of glory. That's the beauty. That's the mystery revealed. Everything in the Old Testament, all the sacrificial system, all the dietary system, the way the temple was set up, all of those things that God laid out centuries and centuries before, he revealed in Christ, and he opened it up to everybody. Christ in you. How do I know heaven's real? It's in me. Christ is in me. That's the hope of glory. It's a hope nobody can take. Christ in you. It's in you. He is in you. He's with you. That means you're never alone. That means you're never without power, and it means that you're never without hope. That's how you exalt Christ above your suffering. You remember where your hope's at. Christ is living in you. I don't know how. I certainly wouldn't want to live inside of some of you, but he is. And he does. I don't like being in my own head sometimes, much less some of yours. I'm just telling you. Christ in you, the mystery totally revealed. And that hope, the Bible says, it's the anchor for our soul. It steadies us in the midst of our suffering, and it keeps us going. And it's just sad that some of us get more excited about a Labor Day sale or a steak dinner than we do about heaven. Listen, this world's not your home. I love a good steak dinner just as much, and I got a free one coming just as soon as I get invited by somebody who owes me one. I don't know when that day's coming. Am I looking forward to it? Yes, but I'm looking forward to heaven a whole lot more. I think Jesus really knows how to work a grill. I'm just telling you, my personal theology, okay? He knows how to run that thing. We're excited about, we have more enthusiasm over hunting season or over football season, although probably not this year and probably never again for me and for some of you. But we have more enthusiasm about some of these earthly things than we do about heaven. We got to get excited about heaven. That's how you work through the pain. You focus above it. Remember, Christ is above. If Paul, listen, think about this. If Paul quits when he's in prison, and he quits when things get hard, do you realize you may have never heard the gospel? You realize that the guy that's locked up, that's been beaten, shipwrecked, all those things, he's the guy that made sure dirty Gentiles like us, I like that, should be the new name of our worship band, dirty Gentiles like us have the gospel. Why? Because a short, crooked-nosed man who could barely see named Paul, who was a boring preacher, decided, I'm not going to let my pain and suffering stop me. I'm going to keep preaching the gospel. And you got to keep going. You got to look past yourself. Why? Because of the hope in you. Look at verses 28 and 29. Paul relied on Christ's power. And I love what he says in verse 28. He says, we proclaim him, warning and teaching everyone. Everyone say everyone. Everyone. With all wisdom, so that we may present everyone. Say everyone. Everyone. Mature in Christ. I love that. He wants everyone saved. Do you realize how few things, there is really nothing in life that is for everyone. Have you ever noticed that? There's a reason why some people are VIP and most of us are not. There's a reason why there's backstage passes and early access and all of these tricks and gimmicks. Not everyone is ever going to be rich. Not everyone can be like John Boy and be a great star-studded athlete. Some of us just, we can't tie our shoes and chew gum at the same time. Some of us just aren't going to have that. Not everyone can be really good looking and handsome like Pastor Dave. Now, we know every Sunday morning that not everyone can sing. Some of us can't carry a tune in a wheelbarrow. It's just not for everybody. Not everybody gets access to clean water or really good food or reasonable shelter. Not everyone will live happily ever after and fall in love. Most things in life are not for everyone, but Jesus Christ is for everyone. And one thing everyone does have in common is that every single person that's ever drawn breath is going to die, and they are going to face him. And on that day, listen to me, it's not going to matter. It's not going to matter how much money is in your bank account. Hey, amen to that. I looked at the balance last night and I said, thank God I'm not buying my way into heaven because I wouldn't make it. Christ is for everyone. We have that message. So no matter how much we struggle with our sin. I still struggle with sin. You still struggle with sin. We're still working. We're still striving. We still know that no matter what, he who began a good work in us is going to be faithful to complete it. Why? I love what he says in verse 29. I labor for this, striving with his strength that works powerfully in me. Not my strength, his strength. In 2007, I went to Africa for the first time. One of the things that I thought was crazy, I hate mowing grass. Anybody else hate cutting grass? I've got neighbors. I've got awesome neighbors, the best neighbors in the world. They never let their grass get like more than that high. It's really hard to keep up with neighbors like that, especially when you don't have a working lawnmower. Thank you, Zach and Jamie and Allison, for letting me borrow yours. But I hate cutting grass, and I always complained about it when I lived on Boogie Lane. I had a push mower, and I had an acre and a half to cut with that push mower. When I got to Africa, one of the craziest things that stuck out to me was they were cutting the grass with scissors. At the compound we stayed at, this is no joke. They were outside, bent over, cutting the grass with scissors. I'm like, I really shouldn't complain about my push mower. I got it a whole lot better. Now that mower has got the power in it. I still have to pull the cord and I still have to walk behind it. It's not in our strength, it's in Christ's strength, but there is still a part for us to play. But when you try to achieve this, presenting ourselves faultless and blameless and holy before Him, you cannot do that in your own strength. You have to rely on the Holy Spirit's power to do that. And when we try to do it in our own strength, it's like trying to cut the grass with scissors. And God's got a zero-turn mower with a 60-inch cut. All you got to do is get on it, buckle in, and use His power. Do it in His strength, not in your own. But it's so hard for us to do that. You know why? Because His power is perfected. This is what the Bible says. His power is only perfected in your weakness. In other words, it only kicks in when you recognize and admit you can't do it on your own. And that's the hang up. Why? Because we think, oh, I don't need anybody. I can do it. I just need to try a little harder. I just need to go a little longer, go a little faster. No, you're probably going to make a bigger mess. What you need to do is recognize Christ above all and surrender to His power. Let Him do the heavy lifting. You just be the willing vessel. We have to labor and strive with His strength. Are you relying on His strength or are your own? I can guarantee you this. Listen to me. If you try to accomplish this holiness thing, this Christ-like thing in your own strength, you try to get through your suffering, you try to get through your pain, you try to conquer your sin, whatever it is, in your own strength, you are either going to give up or you are going to give out. Will happen, trust me. But if we simply say, you know what? Then there was Jesus. I can't do it on my own. That's how every breakthrough in your life begins. Same simple prayer. Same prayer that you started praying when you got saved. Same prayer you continue praying. Father, I need You. Jesus, I need You. I can't do it on my own. I can't handle this relationship stress. I can't handle this financial stress. I can't handle this situation that I'm in. The suffering that's coming at me is too much for me to bear. God, I need You. And when you start that, then He begins to kick in His strength. Kick in His strength. Kick in His strength. And every day, little by little, it doesn't happen. It's not like Popeye, you eat a can of spinach and all of a sudden you can take on the world. That's not how it works most of the time. It's little by little. It's day by day. It's journey by journey. It's trial by trial. It's situation by situation. Jesus gets us through. And then you can, just like my brother Justin, you can put up a testimony this week. That's been a journey, hasn't it, brother? That didn't happen overnight. That was a long, stretched out journey, but the same God who started the work finished the work in His own time. It takes patience to suffer and keep Christ above it. That's the hard part. How do we do that? Remember, you got to prepare for that. Ask the right questions. Instead of asking why, ask what, who, and how. Instead of just getting blindsided, prepare for it, expect it, and be ready when the fight comes to you. And rely on Jesus to get you through it. Why? Because Jesus is above all. Because He's for everyone. And one day, I promise you, we got some people struggling with suffering, struggling with things that they've gone through. And I don't have an easy answer for you. I do know this. One day, all of our whys are going to be answered. One day. Right now, we see as in a glass dimly, but one day, we will know fully, even as we are fully known. When that day comes, we see the Father face to face. We're introduced by Christ Himself. All of the worries and cares and pains of this life will be gone forever. Until then, acknowledge Christ above all. Would you bow your heads? I want the worship team to come. We're going to sing that song one more time. Then there was Jesus. And I just want you, as we sing through that song, I want you just to prepare your hearts right now. Whatever situation, whatever struggle or suffering you are experiencing, let the Holy Spirit work through you and minister to you right now. Let's sing it together.
shadows of the
enemy.
In the fire, in the
flow. Jesus.
Always is and always was. I'll never walk.
Above all, above our sin, above our shame, above our suffering, above our pain, in every single area of our life, there is Jesus. And when He's there, hope is there. And when hope is there, assurance is there that cannot be shaken no matter what life throws at you. Amen? Amen. Don't forget, after we pray, to exit out the front. Give your gift as you leave and carry the hope in you, Christ in you, the hope of glory. Carry that with you this week. Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this awesome day we've got to spend in your presence. We thank you, oh God. In every broken area of our life, you are there to pick us up and put us back together. We can't explain it. It's overwhelming. Lord, it weighs down on us. But Lord, you're always there to hold us together and to carry us through. I pray that that hope, Christ in us, would be the anchor of our soul during these hard times. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. God bless you.
Hello, my name's Dave, and I'm the pastor here at Antioch Baptist Church. I just want to thank you for joining us for this time of praise and worship. I hope that it impacted your life and that it inspired you to take your relationship with God to the next level. If you were watching today and you felt convicted by the Lord to accept Christ as Savior and Lord of your life, I want you to pray this simple prayer with me. Just say, "Dear Jesus, I'm a sinner. I need you to make me new. I invite you into my life to be my Lord and to be my master. I believe that you rose from the dead, and I believe that you are the Son of God, and I believe that you will return to the earth again to take me home to be with you. Jesus, thank you for saving me. Thank you for dying for my sin. I receive you now as my Lord and Savior. Amen." If you prayed that prayer and if you responded to that message today, we'd love to hear about it. I want you to contact us here at the church and let us know about the impact that it's had on your life so that we can celebrate with you and so that we can give you some resources to help you in furthering your walk with Jesus. Thank you so much for tuning in. God bless you. And remember to love, connect, go, and grow.
If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice, tell the same old lies, if you're trying to feel the same old hope.